Piets of Europe. Tuning in for this fantastic final episode of season two with not just one or two, but three special guests, Lauren Comiteau, Cole Verhoeven, and Jonathan Groubert, presented, as always, by your suave and charming host, me, Greg Shapiro. Hi, everybody. Welcome to the United States of Europe. I'm Greg Shapiro, the American Netherlander, and this week, as always, trying to make the EU a little bit less boring. We have three guests in the studio this week, and let's just take a peek at them right now. Jonathan, Cole, and Lauren, and my hand. Hi. Hi, guys.
Hi.
I'm going to talk to you individually in just a minute, but we've got a lot of headlines and backstory for this week to get to. So, you guys ready?
Ready.
All right, feel free to laugh, because you're the studio audience now. and the headlines this week. Giving the EU the respect they deserve by making fun of them just like anybody else. The grand finale. Here we go with the headlines, starting with good news, bad news. The hot topics this week are net neutrality and TTIP. But before we get to that, the EU Commission, the one word who's who, one word reactions to all 28 new EU commissioners. It's a high bar we've set, people, but we're going to try it this week. The other 14, starting with, start the clock, research, science, and innovation. That's this guy. One word, anti-climax. The EU just landed a space probe on a speeding comet. How are you going to top that? Transport. When word, boring, high-speed rail, very nice, but not as sexy as landing a probe on a comet. Next, neighborhood policy and enlargement. Boring! Enlargement into what? Turkey? They don't want us. Ukraine? No fucking way. Next, agriculture and rural development. Subsidies! Farm subsidies are killing the EU, but is Phil Hogan gonna change them? Don't hold your breath. Next, health and food safety. One word, Monsanto. In terms of threats to food safety, the biggest enemy is us. Energy union is next. One word, pipeline. Of course, energy union could mean energy independence, but this guy's poor mandate is to keep that Russian gas a-pumping. The next three ministers or commissioners, let's call them physician heal thyself, starting with international cooperation and development. Croatia. Who better to help cooperation than the country that split off from the rest? And humanitarian and crisis management, in a word, Cyprus. Who better to hand out crisis aid than the country that could use some crisis aid? Cyprus, first put the mask on Greece, then yourself. Next, justice, consumers, and gender equality. One word, sausage party. Who better to facilitate gender equality than an EU commission that is 70% men? Then again, Vera is ready for business. Hell hath no fury like a female Czech justice minister scorned. Next, digital single market. Here we go, people. Untrustworthy. Estonia, the land that brought us Skype, is supposed to protect net neutrality, making sure that the internet remains free. But here's what Andrus had to say on net neutrality. Higher prices for higher speeds would be acceptable. In other words, all internet is created equal, but some more equal than others. Next, digital economy. I think Andrus is going to be bumping heads with this guy, Utinger. As the departing energy union commissioner, he personally brokered a deal, a heating gas deal with Putin and Poroshenko from Ukraine. Badass. So far, this guy has said net neutrality is non-negotiable, and he's German, so you better believe rules are rules. Next up, there are three more commissioners left, and that brings us to this week's good news, bad news. The bad news is, this week, the whole EU Commission started off on the defensive. There were the Luxembourg tax policy documents leaked, aimed at the president, Jean-Claude Juncker. Good news is, Juncker gave a big mea culpa, saying he's here to set things right. Bad news, it was like a week late and half-assed, just justifying every Eurosceptic's case that the EU is a pro-business old boys network. Well, the good news, it ain't just old boys. Enter Denmark's Margrethe Vestager. In a word, trustbuster. Good news, she entered her office with three cases on her desk. Apple in Ireland, Starbucks in the Netherlands, and Fiat in Luxembourg. Luxembourg. That was no accident. And Verstager got to work. Last week, her office announced that Netherlands' huge tax breaks for Starbucks amount to a government subsidy. Why would the EU subsidize an American multinational? Exactly. Good news for Starbucks is they might be able to avoid huge fines. Bad news, well, they'll probably do that by paying years of back taxes. Good news for the EU, bad news for Apple and Fiat, but we're not out of the woods yet. The other huge item on the desk is TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Pact. Good news is such a free trade area would provide a much needed boost for the euro economy. Bad news is you've probably never heard of TTIP until right now, have you? Which in itself is not such bad news, except you know who has heard of TTIP? Big business and corporate lobbyists who are quietly busy with consumer unfriendly ideas such as ISDS. More bad news, if you haven't heard of TTIP, you definitely haven't heard of ISDS, the Investor State Dispute Settlement, otherwise known as the right to sue, as in the right of companies to sue the government for enforcing the law. For example, in Canada, Eli Lilly was denied two patents for pills showing no beneficial medical effect, and now the drug company gets to sue Canada for $500 million in lost revenue. El Salvador, a Canadian company, was denied a gold mine that would contaminate the water supply, so now El Salvador is being sued for $315 million in lost revenue. And the biggest stakes of all, in Ecuador, an American oil company was denied a drilling site in the Amazon rainforest, so now they get to sue Ecuador for $2.3 billion in lost revenue. And they won! The good news is, there are independent courts and judges, of course, bringing fairness to these proceedings. Bad news, these proceedings are basically held in private. It's just four white guys appointed by lobbyist-dominated subcommittees. That is the deal that they're trying to write into the TTIP trade agreement. Good news is, there's a new trade commissioner on the block from Sweden, Cecilia Malmström. Before she was even appointed, she told the EU Parliament, "You'd better not vote for me if you like this right to sue provision because that's a deal breaker." To recap, good news, if you pay attention, as this story develops and shows support for Malmström, then we might not get stuck with a crappy consumer unfriendly deal. The bad news is, you know you won't pay attention. Prove me wrong. That leaves just one more commissioner, education, culture, youth, and sport. How to describe him in a word? Hungarian. I mean, they had to give Hungary something. And now the guy in charge of European culture is from the government that wants to ban the internet. Which brings us to an element of Dutch culture that is getting more interesting on a European scale. Yes, we're going to talk about the Zwarte Piet phenomenon. Move on here. This is the, Frans Timmermans, right now the second in command in Europe, who was as the foreign minister of the Netherlands, posing with one white guy and a bunch of black people doing all the work. To me, that is only one definition, Django chained. Exactly. Oh, and as Dutch people will explain, it's not black. That's just white people in blackface. And as an American, I'm like, that's worse. And it's not just the foreign minister. It was indeed the prime minister. Here's what Mark Rutte had to say at this year's nuclear security summit with Obama in The Hague.
And it is not green Piet or brown Piet. It is black Piet. So I cannot change that. This is an old tradition. And I can only say that my friends in the Dutch Antilles, they are very happy when they have Sinterklaas because they don't have to paint their faces. And when I'm playing for Black Pete, I'm for days trying to get off the stuff on my face.
Mark Rutte, that clears things up. Of course, it might be easier for the Dutch Prime Minister to realize the history of slavery, but it turns out he cut the entire funding for the Dutch Slavery Institute, NINSE, recently. But let's try to get as much history as we can in just a couple minutes. Let's start with prehistory. I mean, this whole Zwarte Piet tradition goes back to the pagan gods, Wodan, or Odin, and the chimney boy, his son, to check the burnt offering for the winter solstice. It's pagan. It's all about dark and light. St. Nicholas, of course, was the bishop who rescued kids, and he had a volunteer who, for a long time, was still, this is more Germanic, not the most pure, in fact, dark and light. Dutch people with Zwarte Piet, at least it's not as messed up as Krampus in Germany. Yeah. Could be worse. Flash forward to 1850, where Sinterklaas and sein Knecht from Jan Schenkman. This is the classic image introducing, yes, just the one Zwarte Piet. But then in 1935, there was Witte Piet. This is the Intocht, or the big parade. And still, a lot of these guys in the recognizable outfits, but not a lot of blackface. So if people want to talk about, oh, let's go back to the way it was done in history, this is what we're talking about. Still just one Knecht or person in blackface. Flash forward to 1945, when apparently the Canadian troops who were stationed in Amsterdam in the Netherlands said, oh, this is a great tradition, we'd like to join in, helping give presents. And blackface, not a problem. They started blacking up, and hey, hence we're back to Django Chained. Flash forward to present day, Zwarte Piet. This is what I came to the Netherlands and found. It reminds me of that movie, science fiction movie, where the aliens emit some substance that humans breathe in so that we don't realize they're actually hideous and aliens. It seems like that's the effect that Zwarte Piet has on most Dutch people that I have talked to. This is like blackface, right? No, no, they insist. It's from the chimney. Yes, the magical Dutch chimney that gets black all over the face and none on their clothes. At all. And the huge afro, of course.
The red lips.
And the red lips, exactly. And 1965, the tradition quietly continues. Zwarte Piet is no longer allowed to have the roux, or the stick for beating the kids, no longer putting them in the sack and taking them away to Spain. This was on the big TV show, Sinterklaas Journal. Sinterklaas says, we're not going to beat the kids anymore. And from now on, Zwarte Piet is just a happy, beloved character that gives the kids the toys. Flash forward to 1995, when they even try something totally politically correct. No more Black Piet, will do Rainbow Piet or Kleuren Piet. That resulted in death threats for the TV producers who put on this guy, and the PC police, well, the opposite, mind control. Flash forward to last year, I was dressed up as Sinterklaas for a video shoot, and I was at the Amsterdam Airport Schiphol, and there was a black woman who came up to me, and I wondered what she would have to say about Zwarte Piet. She said, can I be your Zwarte Piet? I thought, okay, this is clearly not as cut and dry as I want to think. Yes, as an American, let's own up to the fact that Americans are hypocrites. I think, look no further than the Washington Redskins. Yes, the nation's capital has a blatant throwback.
Washington State, dude.
Yeah, Washington State?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Great.
D.C.
Yes. Anyway, moving on. We'll have that debate next. Yes. So, quietly, traditions have been changing. There is the famous cookie called Neger Zoenen. Zoenen, which means kiss. Neger, which does not mean what you think. It means black person. But, of course, the makers, the cookie makers, said, why are we deliberately alienating a whole segment of society? So they changed Neger Zoenen to just Zoenen. And then, quietly, as a throwback, they have another one called, not Neger Zoenen, but Negen Zoenen, just for those who still want to call it what they grew up calling it. Flash forward to 2011, Quincy Gario, of course, the artist who said Zwarte Piet's racism is his new artwork, and of course he was arrested and beaten by Dutch police in Dordrecht for protesting at a Zwarte Piet Sinterklaas parade. And of course, 2013, last year, when Vereen Shepherd from the United Nations, who was apparently not really representing the United Nations, talked about the colonial imagery and the colonial hangover, if you will, of Zwarte Piet, saying, why did the Dutch need Sinterklaas at all when we already have Santa Claus? Basically asking a culture to give up their tradition by making them adopt your tradition, which is, in a word, colonial. And then, of course, the reaction. There was a huge reaction to Vereen Shepherd and the United Nations. Red Zwarte Piet, or Zwarte Piet moet blijven. This was a Facebook phenomenon that got 2 million, I don't know, a huge amount of Facebook followers, likes in a short amount of time. But yet, traditions continue to change. McDonald's would have a normal Zwarte Piet image here, but no Zwarte Piet anymore. Fine, we'll just have the traditional cookies. HEMA, Intertoys, international retailers are starting to realize maybe Zwarte Piet doesn't sell so well. CC says, well, why not have Zwarte Piet as an orange? And even Albert Heijn said, sure, we'll have him an orange, but somehow we still need to keep a little bit of a reminder there. So then we get to progress again. This is this year on the Sinterklaas Journal. It looks like Rootpiet or just soot. Maybe then they go too far. In Gouda this year, they have Kaaspiet, Measles Piet. There's also Hellraiser Piet. This is supposed to be a Stroopwafel, but to me, this is as scary as this guy. Talk about Krampus. So this year, there were riots in Gouda, as the whole argument now has been radicalized. This year, a black woman was beaten in, and last year as well, just for protesting, or this woman was protesting as well against the United Nations, but was beaten apparently for assuming that she would be pro Zwarte Piet. And then you get to stuff like these comments, which basically say, next we'll have to, close the zoos because you people will come across your ancestors. Yes, my ancestors put your people on the boats. Those were the days. Now you people have too much freedom, and Zwarte Piet is not racist. All you people are retarded. And of course, then you see graffiti like this, which says Turks go back to Morocco, which just means that so far there are apparently some radical elements here, and we do have a real problem. So let's now talk about Zwarte Piet Unchained, and we'll talk to our guests. We're going to skip the 6 and 60 this week, and we'll go right to our guests. Yes. Let's start in reverse order. Lauren Comiteau, hi.
Hello.
A journalist, and let's talk about briefly your background. From the U.S.?
From the U.S., from New York.
And you're working on, we knew each other from Time Out Amsterdam, but now you're working on AMAG.
Yes, I write a column for AMAG.
And you have a lot of freelance experience.
I do, over the past 18 years.
And how long have you been in the Netherlands?
18 years.
Aha. And Cole Verhoeven.
Hi.
Hi. So,
I don't need to talk about my background. I just want to get right into it.
Yeah, exactly. let's get right into it. Well, yeah, I mean, but performance artist, and singer, and great. Well, good to have you. I'll get back to you in just a moment.
Great.
Jonathan Groubert, of course, from What's Up Amsterdam podcast. And
And I've lived here for 23 years, and I'm someone who likes to interrupt other people when they're presenting TV shows.
There we go. Well, thanks for joining us. But fine, Cole, you had something to say? I know. There's a lot of like taking notes during that little history section. So what have you got?
No, I mean, it's... we started off saying, the people tell me, oh, it's not blackface. And I mean, now we have to like start to reinvent the wheel to say it is blackface. It's such as a...
Yeah. And do you remember like...
very first experience with blackface?
What was everyone's first experience with the...
I was in the Bayernkorf and...
in the big department store.
Yeah, the big department store here.
Piece.
And I had no idea.
Well,
it was October.
Climbing.
Pete's got hanging.
And I think I had a kind of... something similar to an epileptic seizure. One of those staring seizures, like, you know, and not even aware of my surroundings except for that. And so that was my very first time. And then, of course, the flooding. But in the years that followed, I managed to, like, get out of town all the time. 3 years until I had my son. And now I'm, like, stuck here dealing with this.
But how old is your son now?
He's six.
And?
So 6 years I've been trying to, you know, subversively stickers and doing stuff.
I've got kids as well, and I will say that my
kids
used to be big into Zwarte Piet, Sinterklaas, and now have gotten a little older. My wife is Dutch, by the way, and she was also schooling me for years. It is not the way you think
it is. Yeah.
But now she is actually 180 degrees. She's like, with the kids, we're not celebrating this anymore.
And that was that's why she changed.
I'm just like wondering
a little bit,
but the fact is, it's in the school system. I mean, you go there, and there's the school system that is dictated by the Sinterklaas Journal. They watch it 3 to 5 days a week in school.
It's
that's
a televised
ridiculous
phenomenon in America. We grew up with the Christmas specials. Basically.
We didn't watch it in school. You know,
no,
we didn't get like
school.
Blackface lessons in school. Like you're gonna like this.
Well, now let's say you know this year there's progress. We were talking about the head Piet on the show. The head Zwarte Piet is no longer all well. He's still in the
he's
normal
a little
blackface,
brown.
But he's a little,
That's kind of racist without making something less racist by making it more racist.
Really?
I mean,
the transformation, they said, okay, we're going to come up, present a new Piet. He's got straight hair. He's a little bit less black.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I think
that's the more racist. Like, we have a more acceptable black person because he's a little less black and he's got nice straight hair.
I mean, I think the official line is there. I mean, the mayor has said he wants to try to get a more palatable Piet in over 4 years.
The mayor of Amsterdam. Who is a lawyer.
But what's a palatable black person?
Right.
That's a little less black, you know?
And a quarter of the Piets at the Intocht were, they say, were less black. Well, it's kind of hard to tell the difference.
100 of the 400,
So then you're going
we're facing a big problem because the fact of the matter is, like it or not, something more than 80% of the entire nation still sees Black Pete, the traditional Black Pete, as something that they want to keep exactly as it is.
And what's the percentage? 80%?
It's more than 80%. Which is, you know, that's overwhelmingly the majority of the country. We so, like it or not, this is something that's still, you know, and there's this perception, of course, that things are changing, they're moving along, that they're legislating things in courts, but you can't legislate hearts and minds.
Yeah.
And clearly, the hearts and the minds of the vast majority of people who live in this country want to keep it the way it is. And that, of course, for the people who want to force change, this is, for me, stepping outside of my opinion entirely, just talking about how it is, that's a massive uphill battle, much more than people seem to think it is.
Well, that's my big question in terms of Europe and the European Union. I mean, this could indeed be a case of civil rights or human rights that goes to the European Court of Justice in Luxembourg, in which case we might have a sort of, you know, a Supreme Court-like decision that gets handed down. Is that what we want, or is that going to indeed not just fail to win hearts and minds, but maybe even harden the hearts and minds
turn into a backlash,
make it more radical?
Could give authorities a way out of a situation they may not want to deal with.
Right. It could, indeed.
So Dutch authorities might welcome such a change.
I think maybe it just has to come from. So you can just say, I don't have any responsibility. They did this. Okay, we can't do it anymore. And you can kind of back out that way instead of having to admit that you knew there was this concept as blackface and you knew that we've been doing it. I mean, they say it's for the children, but the children didn't decorate the party, you know.
Right.
Someone said, hey, you know what? Let's co-opt the blackface aesthetic and we're going to paint them up. And the kids are going to love it.
Yeah.
Because paper notes.
Indeed, kids seem to have no problem with white Pete or different.
They have
color
no problem with any Pete. It's the adults that decided we're going to do blackface.
Yeah.
And but we're not going to call it that. Even though, and I got visual aids.
This,
from the Smithsonian blackface kit.
Can you hold it up?
I can try. Let's see. And then there's is from Zwarte Piet is racism, courtesy of their site. And then there's another set from Albert Heijn and one from the Dirk.
Yeah.
And then you can say what are the differences? I don't see. Okay, the price is different. This one was 10 cents and this one was $1.49 with a bonus card.
Right.
And then the hat is different. So you can't claim ignorance. Like, I never heard of blackface, but by coincidence this looks exactly like blackface.
So
you know, I was at the Intalk this Sunday and I was interviewing, just talking to different people who were there with their children. And I spoke to this one woman who clearly was a bit fed up, like, oh, I think this whole thing
so
is ridiculous.
At the big parade.
Yeah.
At the parade.
I was too, but I was
the boats coming down with my microphone and my kids. And because that will be relevant in a minute. So this one woman said, okay, you know, she really is kind of over the whole thing, but her little kids, 5 or 6, are already like, it's fine. You know, they don't care. They don't notice. Her 9-year-old thinks it's bullshit. But, you know, that she'll begrudgingly accept it is the point. And you can see, like, it will take a generation to get out.
Yeah.
Of course, my daughter's line was like, I don't really think it matters because it's make-believe.
Unfortunately, the let's change Zwarte Piet a little bit has turned into the backlash of don't get rid of Zwarte Piet. Wait, whoa, no.
Yeah, that's
some
a,
of us
that's
are not a, talking about getting rid of it.
That's just a leap of logic to throw something in that doesn't really have anything to do with it. Like, oh, you're going to try to get rid of everything and then all the crackers are, you know.
It's been conflated. The pro-Zwarte Piet movement has conflated the criticism of Zwarte Piet's image with you want to get rid of the whole holiday.
Right.
But now, let me put this out
unfair.
There.
That's unfair.
And on behalf of the pro-Zwarte Piet people, just for the sake of debate, what if political correctness takes over? What if European rules are adhered to more closely? And what if this unique element of Dutch culture ends up being, and you know what? Let's throw in the Dutch drug laws and the Dutch prostitution.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, that uniqueness of Dutch culture, that's not so important.
I don't think it's such a slippery slope. And if you look at legally what happens, I mean, you know, the mayor in this particular case where for the case last year where the lower where the court ruled that he should have granted not have granted the license for the parade and then the Supreme Court overturned it saying well actually he cannot judge on content, he can only judge on public order and safety, so and if once we do that then are we going to not do gay parade and this and and they said if you have a problem go to another court, so and same with the cleanup of the red light district, you know, there are limits, and so I think it's, you know, you can't just say we're going to throw out this and then everything is going to go with it. I just don't think it's such a slippery slope.
Okay, good.
Just,
we are heading into
passive aggressive
final arguments here. You mentioned the personal, Lauren. You've your kids. Sorry, Cole, you were talking about your kids as well, and maybe Jonathan's as well. But
as somebody who is also an American, and as a result, you know, raised in a certain period in the United States where we got the memo where certain things were really, really not okay.
I got that memo.
Okay, yeah. The first time I encountered Zwarte Piet, it was absolutely shocking to me, not just because of that imagery, but also because of the fact that it flew in the face of Dutch society.
Yeah.
So I then had my hard and fast opinion, which I then stated, I remember in Bayonair News Radio many years ago, said that and got shut down real hard.
Yeah,
by the people, they did not want to hear it. Even the people who were presenting it wouldn't let me express my opinion anymore.
Right.
That's how serious it got. This is the 90s.
Yeah, yeah.
But I was not allowed to say much about it. But then my son got asked to be a Zwarte Piet by the woman from the Antilles, who was herself black, and said, we'd like to paint up your son.
Right.
And then school. I was like, yeah, at the after school, and I was like,
no way.
I'm not going to get involved with it. It's his decision.
Right.
It's my opinion. But you're a black woman asking him to, you know, you're making this really complicated.
Tell me about it. You know, I had a letter that I took around to school saying, okay, can we just do something about the blackface this year? I thought you guys got the memo last year and after the protest. I had a lot of signatures. The principal really mad at me. I had some black women who were like, I'm not going to sign. They were afraid. And and they're sitting in school now under this blackface posters. And and I also,
so quickly, because I think it sums up so much. I met a man from Suriname at the parade one year with his kids. I said, what do you think of Zwarte Piet? Yeah. He said, I was called Zwarte Piet when I was young. Right. I was taunted. I'm like, what are you doing here with your kids? He said, my parents wouldn't let me join the party. I got no presents. And it was so frustrating. I want to spare them that frustration.
Yeah. But
for
a lot
him,
of
it was more frustrating not to be part of the party.
Yeah.
No, it's also very frustrating to be called Zwarte Piet when you're a child. It's horrible.
Well, folks, if you want to see more of this debate, that is clearly not the final word, but what will your Europeans have to say about it, we'll find out next time. And thanks for watching. Thanks for watching this whole season. And thank you, Broadcast Amsterdam. Don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel. Doei!